Kevin, let's talk about the I-League qualifiers. Mohammedan Sporting Club, one of the storied football clubs in the country, has emerged on top of the I-League qualifiers that conclude today. The I-League is, of course, the second tier in the club football scene in the country, with the Indian Super League or the ISL being the top tournament. Though the calendar is not out yet, the 2020-21 season of the I-League is likely to begin in Kolkata in December, while the ISL could begin in Goa in November. The qualifiers were the first major sporting event held in India following the pandemic, and they were staged in an eco-bubble in three venues in Kolkata. Now, there was some off-the-pitch controversy as well, as the coach of Mohammedan SC, Yann Law, quit after allegations of match-fixing were thrown about. Despite this, the team came on top and will play in the I-League. So, what are the lessons from the qualifiers, where at least two cases of COVID-19 were recorded? What does the All India Football Federation have to watch out for as it gets ready to hold the two tournaments in the coming months? We talked to NewsClick's Leslie Xavier to find out more.
Thank you, Leslie, for joining us. So, as we've seen, the I-League qualifiers have concluded. Mohammedan SC has qualified for the league. And this has been an interesting experiment because it's been done in an eco-bubble. Like you mentioned earlier, it's one of the first major sporting events to happen in India. So, we'll get into some of the more detailed aspects later, but first impressions regarding how the tournament was held in the context of this pandemic. What do you think?
So it's restart of sporting action that way in India because and a major tournament as such, because this was the qualifying tournament for the next season of the I-League, which is supposed to start in November, but I guess they have moved it ahead, postponed it a little bit more because logistics have to be figured out. So this was a pilot project in a way, a smaller tournament, 2 weeks. Five matches to be exact, and five teams were involved, and they were just playing each other once. So it was a single round robin format, and the team which ended up scoring the highest points won. So it in essence was a knockout tournament, straightforward shootout for the qualifying slot. And Mohammedan did well because they sealed the title in the third round itself. After the three matches, they scored 9 points and unassailable lead. So, in fact, they are playing today, but that is an inconsequential match as such because they have already sealed the title. And as far as the club's performance is concerned, the Mohammedan was the most set team in the mix. We had Bangalore United, we had Garhwal FC from Delhi. We had RIFC, which is from Ahmedabad, and we also had Bhawanipur FC, which is from West Bengal. And the surprise package of the league was Bhawanipur FC. I know outside of the footballing fraternity, Bhawanipur it doesn't ring the bell. Like some of the bigger clubs in Calcutta, in and around Calcutta, like Mohun Bagan or East Bengal. But Bhawanipur has been a regular fixture in the Calcutta League, and they have a decent history. They have a long-standing history in the game also. And it was heartening to see them come out, and though at the start of the tournament, people had not given them much of a reckoning once the tournament started, and they had decent foreign players in their ranks who all came through well, and they seemed to be a well-gelled side. And when Bhawanipur and Mohammedan Sporting played each other on Saturday, it was virtually a final. The winner would have sealed the title. So two clubs who are part of the Calcutta League, they played each other, and of course Mohammedan had a stronger, larger team, right, and they came through. Another surprise or rather shock was seeing Bengaluru United underperformed. They were also a club which was, initially before the tournament, they were supposed to give a run they were one of the front runners for the title, for qualifying. But they just, the team never gelled together. And also, they were one of the two teams which had a COVID positive case, right, among the players. Bangalore United had one player and Bhawanipur FC had one player. So whether that offset their plan or whether it was just the sheer fact that in the pandemic situation, teams, it was obvious, never had a chance to train together. For example, a team like RIFC or a team like Garhwal FC. So these are teams who, I mean, who couldn't not just get, convene the players together, not just because of the pandemic, but because of the finances involved also. These are teams that make ends meet on a season-to-season basis. So those teams, I mean, considering all these factors, them getting together and then giving commendable performances on the pitch, that was great to see. And also, as journalists and as football fans, it was finally great to see some Indians playing sport.
Absolutely. And in this context, you mentioned the COVID-19 cases at the Eco Oval. We know that the much bigger tournament, the ISL, is also coming up soon. So, with regard to the preparations, what do you see as the lessons that should be learned ideally from this experience? What was done right? Anything to look forward to?
Like I said at the start itself, that this was a pilot for the football organizers in the country. The larger tournament being ISL as well as the I-League, which happens to be the second tier tournament as things stand in the Indian football context. ISL is supposed to start in November. As of now, I mean, the dates are not fixed yet, the fixtures are not fixed yet, but the teams have all convened in Goa at the Eco Bubbles. They're training together. We have, in fact, a couple of regulars of our show, 420 Glance. Ishfaq Ahmed is attached with Kerala Blasters as an assistant coach. Venedi Singh, who is also one of the experts who comes for our show, he is assistant coach with East Bengal, and they're both at the Eco Bubbles training with the team. So, training has started, but no foreigners are there in the mix yet because visa issues are there. So, none of the players are foreign players or the foreign coaches have. I mean, all the coaches, in fact, because ISL teams are all coached by foreigners, the head coaches. So none of the head coaches are here. So they are all, I mean, communicating virtually and getting things moving. So that is one reason why, with this uncertainty happening, that's one reason why the final calendar has not been finalized yet. But it's going to be a 5-month-long tournament and competition. And the same with I-League, it's going to be a long-drawn competition. So taking this idea of the Eco Bubble, which was, you can say experimented because all the factors that were put in, all the protocols put in were new for the teams involved. And then taking it into a larger plane there. And looking at how things were managed, I would say AFF did amicably well. For a change, I'm not criticizing the Federation. But yeah, they like, for instance, I said two cases that came out at the start, just before the start of the tournament. They were isolated. They were asymptomatic cases, and they were treated obviously. But then this happened after the teams had started training together once the quarantine period got over. So that's a tricky period because the players interact with each other. So luckily, it didn't become a cluster spread as such, and things were in control. And then, of course, on the pitch, yeah, there were instances where we thought that referees looked a little rusty, players themselves looked a little rusty, especially the opening fixtures. But they all played well. They seemed decently fit given the circumstances. But there are a couple of things that lessons that probably the ISL clubs can learn from the clubs that played here, right. ISL and I-League clubs, and one being how to manage the players within the system. Of course, this is, like I keep saying, this was a smaller tournament, but the playing dynamics, the fitness of the players, how to prepare these players for the match, all these things remain the same. It's just that it's going to be a long drawn affair at the larger tournament. So that is one lesson that these guys, the other tournament clubs and officials can take away from. And the other much more important aspect that they should learn, or they should understand how or why or what, how to manage exactly, is the synergy of the team, the team's state of being and the team's unity. Because that's something that was not discussed so far. And then suddenly when the I-League qualifier happened, huge controversy erupted because the champions, Mohammedan Sporting, even though they had a smooth run of victories on the pitch, off the pitch, it was madness. Huge controversy erupted over there, and the coach resigned or sacked, depending on which people you believe, left midway. And then the team went on to win the subsequent matches. That's probably the credit goes to the coach himself, because he must have set the team right. But yeah, this controversy happened, which could have been avoided, but it was a nasty affair. I can explain that.
Right. Yes, actually, that's something I was going to ask as well. You've written about it also. There was some controversy, the allegations of match, although it's a very short tournament, but nonetheless, allegations of match fixing thrown around. And this always kind of puts fans, the players themselves, everyone in a very bad state of mind. So could you just maybe take us through what exactly is likely to have happened in this scenario? And again, what are the lessons that should be learned from this?
So the main three characters in this whole episode is Mohammed's sporting management, Jan Loh, the now former coach, and Ranjit Bajaj, who is the owner of Minerva Academy, Football Academy, formerly Minerva Punjab FC owner. And Bajaj is quite a character. Anything controversial in Indian football, anything to tweet, anything, I mean, he is there. So Bajaj happened to be staying at it is, I think, Hyatt in Calcutta. He happened to be staying at the same Nico Bubble Hotel as the Mohammed sporting team was playing.
Right.
And Jan Loh, being formerly from Punjab FC, I mean, Minerva Punjab. So he has friendship, he has connections with Ranjit Bajaj probably. And suddenly after the first match, there was rumors doing the round, WhatsApp forwards doing the round, that Jan Loh has been discussing match dynamics, the team dynamics with Ranjit Bajaj, giving him information on the playing 11. And it amounts to match fixing in a way, because you are giving out valuable information to a third party, to an outsider.
Absolutely.
So that's a huge allegation. And of course, any coach wouldn't want to be linked with, I mean, alleged match fixing, even if it's not proven. That's to mid tournament. Right. And so he came out, he said, I'm resigning. And then the entire episode went into nasty turf by the club management trying to justify their side of things by saying that match fixing one. Second thing is that Jan Loh was deciding team composition on his own without discussing the team management. Or team management's inputs were not taken seriously by the coach. So, I mean, let's just be very clear. In footballing terms, the coach has the final say as far as which players play. He decides the formation, he decides the idea of, or the philosophy of play. So, Jan Loh was very much in his own rights to decide what his playing 11 is. So, management getting involved in it, that's unprofessional to say the least. And so, anyway, so that was the allegation. Then Ranjit Bajaj came out, I mean, threatening a defamation case of his own. Police cases have been filed. Some WhatsApp message leaks have happened. So it's entirely a mess. So then, but the key here in my piece, which I addressed last week, was the All India Football Federation, whose tournament it is, they were silent about it the entire time. We contacted a couple of officials, senior officials as such, who are involved in the action. They said, we were not involved because it's an internal affair, club internal affair. But it's not, because match fixing allegation is involved here. So either the AFF, All India Football Federation, should have stepped in and made the club realize that this is not done. If you have a domestic issue within the club, you should deal it in a professional way, not by throwing around words like match fixing, if at all it's not happened. And secondly, they should have also launched an investigation of their own and brought out their own version, or at least a release saying that we are on top of this and we are investigating what exactly happened. But they were silent altogether. So that was the point that I addressed in that piece. But the larger picture that I wanted to provide, which is a takeaway from this tournament for the ISL or the I-League clubs, is that this is a real situation within the eco bubble that could happen to any club. So we are talking about, say, arbitrary case. ISL club, of course, the club owners won't, or the management or the senior management of the club won't be there in the eco bubble. They're all businessmen, business owners. They would be staying out and keeping a tab of things. They would have a representative in the eco bubble, And then we have players and the player management and the support staff. And so the owner or the board of directors or the main controllers of the club, the business side of business wing of the club, they would obviously be dependent on their representative to give information as to what is happening. They would have their inputs, they would get back their information. And if a break of, I mean, and which can easily happen, I believe that this is what happened in Calcutta as well in the case of Mohammedan Sporting. A break of information and then misinformation and then someone deciding to believe someone's story, someone's version, and then suddenly some things were said, some things came out, and then it just escalated beyond. So to maintaining the team spirit, so to speak, if at all spirit is a tangible value to be used here, but it is, because the balance of the team, the happiness of the team, it's 5 months you're talking about, and in our previous chats we have discussed how that it can be a tremendous toll on the players, on the coaches, because pressure of winning, losing, pressure of being away, isolated, pressure of just, I mean, too much of football also is a problem. Like, there is life beyond that also, where the players can relax and then come back and play. So that is not going to happen this time around. So anyways, the players and the management and all the people involved in gameplay are stretched beyond limit. Stretched to unprecedented limits, I would say, because these are things that they are not used to. They are not prepared for it. So they will learn as they go, and obviously tempers might flare. Obviously there will be some decisions which may not go well. And then so if information flow is not managed properly, then this episode can play out in any of the clubs. So this is a serious lesson which everyone, including the All India Football Federation, should take cognizance of and should plan or should keep in mind when they're dealing with all the dynamics that is happening within the ISL eco bubble, ISL or I-League eco bubble. And last and final, I mean, takeaway I would say is just also ensure that on the pitch everything goes fair, which is again one aspect of it is ensuring that no element of corruption or even shadow of corruption comes onto the league, because that is the last thing that you want in a pandemic situation where you are organizing sport as a restart. And so it's bad for the sport. It brings the entire sport to disrepute. So
absolutely,
I'm just hoping that the AIFF and the authorities and the FSDL, which runs the ISL, they are all looked at this mini tournament that happened and understands this aspect also, and probably be more hyperactive about instances such as these, and ensure that it's nipped in the bud, so that it doesn't bring the entire competition and the game itself into disrepute.
Absolutely right. Thank you so much, Leslie. We'll be tracking these tournaments as they happen and discussing more of this. Thank you so much.
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from the world and the country. Until then, keep watching NewsClick. Mm-hmm.